بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم، والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, it always gives me pleasure to come back to this community and talk to you and listen to your thoughts, your dua, and to interact with the brothers, to feel one more time that this ummah is indeed an ummah alive. It's an ummah that cannot be disunited by race, by ethnicity, by language, by anything. An ummah that's united by the Kitabullah Azza wa Jal, by the belief in Allah Azza wa Jal as the one and only one God, by the belief in our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was sent to humanity, to mankind as mercy, as one who would save this world from the injustice, the oppression, and the oppressive of all types of regimes and systems. Tonight, I will make some reflections on some of the ayat of the Quran, and I selected the ayat from Surah Al-Isra for several reasons. One major reason, because it does talk about Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, which is the center of attention of the entire world today. Second reason is that we are in the final days of Rajab, the month of Isra, the month on the 27th of Rajab, which is coming in a few days, when Allah Azza wa Jal provided Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with an ultimate journey all the way from Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and then up to the heavens, where he met and he saw firsthand what he is told about in the Quran. And the third reason yet, which not many people talk about, there is these both two first incidents, or the talk about Al-Aqsa and the talk about Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. These are things which are so dear to our hearts, and we love them. We love Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, we love Al-Isra, we love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as much as we can, and we expend all our efforts, all our emotions to be in love with that entity, with that person, with that messenger, with that Prophet of Allah Azza wa Jal. But there is yet one more event that happened in Rajab, which again, it not only touches our hearts, but it really squeezes our hearts all the way because of the apathy that it carries, which is the abolishment and the destruction of the last post of the Islamic Khilafah state, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam established with his own hands when he migrated to Medina. That was on the 28th of Rajab, almost 100 years ago. Actually, it's 94 years ago, because 100 years ago is the regular calendar, or the AC calendar. It was the Hijri time in Rajab, about 93-94 years ago. So there are all of these circumstances that pushes someone to come and reflect on what happened, what Allah Azza wa Jal is talking about in Surah Al-Isra. And I will read the first few ayat, then I will choose and select what is it that we need to take out of these, what type of concepts Allah Azza wa Jal want us to inculcate and to shape our personalities. He begins the surah, as all of you know, not many, but I'm pretty sure each and every Muslim reflects on this so many times, where he says, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan minal masjid al-haram إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير. Before I go any further, very interesting that Allah Azza wa Jal in this ayah, in this surah, he talks about المسجد الأقصى, that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was taken into a journey from Masjid al-Haram to المسجد الأقصى, which makes this coupling, this tight coupling between these two masajid, number one. Number two, Al-Masjid Al-Haram المسجد الحرام until محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم came. When he came, this was a place known to be al-Masjid al-Haram, which was reconstructed by Ibrahim عليه السلام. Very well known. And when Ibrahim عليه السلام reconstructed the masjid, when it says, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ, Ibrahim was raising the bases which were already there, raising bases of the bayt, of the house of Allah Azza wa Jal, meaning that this house had already been built and destroyed, and Ibrahim came to re-establish it. And the narrations and the history and the seerah and the tafsirs, they say that Adam alayhi salam was the first to build that place where Allah Azza wa Jal says, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا. The first house ever, first house ever built for the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal was the one that was in Mecca. And he called it Bibakka. Bakka is another pronunciation of the word Mecca. It's not a different name, but this is Arabs, they had different pronunciations where they can substitute the M, the Mim, with a Ba, with different letters. Mim can be substituted for a Noon, like Ismail, Ismail, and Mecca to Bakka. And here he talks about traveling to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. But before that time, that place was never called a masjid. Because the word masjid is very much associated with Islam. The Christians, the Jews, those who worship, who used to worship, or supposedly they had to worship Allah Azza wa Jal, they had different names. Like al-Kanisa, al-Ma'bad, the temples, they had all types of names, but they never had the name Masjid for any of their places of worship. So the naming of that place, al-Masjid, al-Aqsa, was given in this surah. Meaning that this is an indication, in fact, there is an ayah in this surah. It says, وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. All of these ayat that he talked about in Surah Al-Usra, Isra, بُشْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This is a glad tiding that Allah Azza wa Jal is giving, بُشْرَى, بِشَارَى, for mu'mineen. So this was a bishara. This was a promise. This was a sign that this place would become a masjid and would be named Al-Aqsa. So this is a masjid named by Allah Azza wa Jal. Just that Al-Masjid Al-Haram is a name, is a masjid named by Allah Azza wa Jal. أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكَ وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. Allah Azza wa Jal called this Al-Bayt Al-Haram. So this is the sacred bayt, the sacred house of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this one, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, is named by Allah Azza wa Jal, is called Al-Masjid by Allah Azza wa Jal, not by the Arabs, not by the Palestinians, not by anyone, not by even Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu anhu, who conquered the place. He is not the one who called it Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Allah called it Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in the Quran. So it remains Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa as long as this Quran lives. And anyone who has in his mind, in the background of his mind, emotions, whatever, wants to destroy the Palestinians, kick the Palestinians, evict the Palestinians, and then conquer the area, they can do whatever they want, whatever they can. And they are doing it as much as they can. They can never destroy this Quran. This will never be erased from the hearts of the Ummah of 2 billion people. This will, even if the 2 billion people are gone, Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا, if you turn your back against this book, يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالَكُمْ. Allah will replace you with better people who will never be like you. If you let this Quran and what's in it, if you let it go and you do not support it, you do not stand behind it, Allah Azza wa Jal will have other people. Whether he will create new ones, bring them from other nations, from wherever, it's Allah Azza wa Jal, that's his decision, he knows what he does. That's one. That's first reflection on the first ayah. First ayah establishes a fact on the ground, not a fact by because we are fighting for it, because there are groups, militias, resistance, a nation is being driven out. No, not because of that. All of this happens in the world, in all types of wars, all types of conflicts. Many things happen. But the Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is something that no one can change its reality. You can destroy it. You can destroy the building, as it was done for Al-Masjid Al-Haram. Al-Masjid Al-Haram, its building was destroyed. When Ibrahim alayhi salam came all the way to Mecca, when Allah Azza wa Jal ordered him to go and start in Mecca his part of his life, Allah Azza wa Jal showed him the location of the place, and he ordered him to reconstruct the masjid, and him and his son Ismail. وَذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. That's again in the Quran. So that's fact number one. Now, around this fact, Allah Azza wa Jal talks also that although this place, this masjid is sacred, although this masjid is a masjid that Allah Azza wa Jal designates, although it's a place that is tightly coupled with Mecca, but that in itself is not a guarantee, is not a guarantee to have this masjid always in decent hands. It's not a guarantee. You have to work hard in order to keep it up and running as a masjid. And here he talks that there will come at least two times where the Bani Israel will get hold of the vicinity of this masjid and will cause all types of atrocities. That's what the other ayats they talk about, where it says, وَقَضَيْنَا إِلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ وَلَتَعْلُنَّ عُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. You will have the chance and the ability to cause corruption and destruction in the land. And the land here is the land surrounding Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. There are some people, some place they would say, no, it talks about any land. No, it doesn't talk about any land. It talks about that particular land, which is in the vicinity of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, because the whole surah is about this issue. This surah is not talking about Morocco or Bangladesh or Indonesia or Amman or Cairo. It's talking about Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and its vicinity. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, yes, Bani Israel can cause destruction in this area, can take control of this area, and can cause all types of corruption. And they will. And they will do. Not only once, but twice. Not only once, but twice. And all of this, when they do that, it is because of your inability to keep control. Because something within you, within this ummah, will happen that will enable an enemy or someone who is external, outsider, whatever you want to call it, can take over. And they did. And they did. He talks about twice. It's already the second time, at least depending on many of recent mufassirin. If we talk about the tafsirs that happened, that took place on the 3rd and the 4th century of Hijrah, they always talk about the control of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa before the rise of Islam. Allah Azza wa Jal talks about after. He does not talk about the before, what happened. He talks about what is going to happen to this Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. That the Ummah at some point will lose its grip, will lose its power, will not be able to keep up with the ideals and the morals and the power of Islam, as he talked about it in other places. This is an ummah. It's an ummah made of flesh and blood. An ummah that's made of emotions. An ummah that's made of all types of desires. An ummah that does have belief in Allah Azza wa Jal, but every now and then they just wander around some certain lively issues. In fact, this reminds me of a place where Allah Azza wa Jal talks about the Muslims even at the time of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wassalam. Even at the time, especially in the battle of Uhud, where very clearly he talks about these people, حَتَّى إِذَا فَشِلْتُمْ وَتَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ وَعَصَيْتُمْ So this continues to be your victory, your upper hand. You will remain victorious until you start, you become losers. فشلتم, you lose. You lose. You become incapable. وتنازعتم في الأمر. You start quarreling about who's going to be more visible. At least. Visible in leadership, visible in money, in wealth. وتنازعتم في الأمر. فشلتم. وتنازعتم في الأمر. وعصيتم. وعصيتم. You go against the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. You disobey. The disobedience. Once these three characteristics happen, of course, the ayah continues, من بعد ما أراكم ما تحبون. After you have seen lots of good things from Allah Azza wa Jal. And then Allah Azza wa Jal will took that power from you because of what you have done. Now, if we look at the current situation, what is happening in Palestine, you see the ummah, the entire ummah is crippled, is not able to provide one bottle of water to the people who need it. Although everyone in his own home, in his own self, within his own heart, he wishes or she wishes to bring and support and provide everything you have. But you can't do that. Why? Because you have already fashiltum. You already tanaza'tum fil amr. You quarreled about who is going to rule what. You already asaytum. You disobeyed Allah Azza wa Jal. You allowed the tyranny to prevail. I'm talking about us, the Muslim Ummah. We allowed tyranny to prevail. We allowed regimes to bring all types of these so-called singers, men, women, nudity, everything in the heart of Muslim world, in the best places of the Muslim world. Leave alone Istanbul, leave alone Amman or Cairo, the one that has been corrupted with all types of corruption. Today, that corruption is in the vicinity of Hijaz, Mecca, Medina, Jeddah, Riyadh, all of this. You have let go not only of the ideas and the ideals of Islam, but even your morals, your ethics about Islam. You let go. The Muslim Ummah did let go. No, no, no. Someone will say, oh, brothers, it's not us. It's MBS who is doing that. But who sustains MBS in power? No, no. It is Sisi who is stopping the army from marching and helping, supporting the people in Gaza. It's not us. It's Sisi. It's his army. It's his leaders. But who allowed that Sisi to come into power and kept him there and is not able to evict him? Who does that? Who stands up in masajid and makes a dua for a king here or a king there? Or scholars. Hatta idha fashiltum, you fail to establish Islam, you fail to establish the rules of Islam, you fail to stop the riba in the heart of Islam, you fail to stop the zina, the munkar in the heart of the Muslim world. You fail to stop the atrocities, the killing within the Muslim world, aside from Palestine and the occupation. Everywhere else, you failed to stop the destruction of Babri Masjid in India. You are going to fail to stop the next destruction, which may happen tonight or tomorrow. You fail to do all of this. You fail to bring the Muslim Ummah as one Ummah again. Yes, we are one Ummah here. But go to any place in the world, in the Muslim world, you need a visa, you need permission, and you could be denied. They could say, no, you don't qualify. Even for Hajj, they can stop you. If they find some reason that you are absolutely, they call it political, you are politicized, you are not even allowed to come there. And these are facts. I'm not talking that something that could be. These are facts. And I know the facts. And I know exactly the facts. I know people who get rejected a Hajj or Umrah visa. We have failed to make Islam the prevalent ones. حتى إذا فشلتم وتنازعتم في الأمر, and we start quarreling. Now, after all this destruction that's happening in Gaza, do you know what is the main subject being discussed by people outside behind the scenes in Cairo and in Qatar. Who is going to rule what? Who is going to have a post? What's the distribution percentage of power? What power are you talking about? You have been destroyed, you have been dead, you have been killed. More than 100,000 people have been martyred. Not only 30,000 as they speak. These are the ones that they were able to bury. They are able to bury and they identified. There are thousands more who are not identified, who are not found, who are buried under the rubble that nobody can take out. And by the time, every day, the other day, they said, oh, we just found beneath the rubbles around 100 people who have already dissolved. Dissolved. Humans dissolved. These are facts. And what are we doing? We continue to argue. تنازعتم في الأمر. We are quarreling. Who is going, how much percentage of the power you are going to get? 10% for this group, 10% for that group. The old PLO wants to have a big share. The fighters today, they want to have the bigger share. This is exactly what the Quran talked about when Allah Azza wa Jal showed them that you can lose even when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was there. Even when the Prophet was there, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you lost and you ran away and you turned your back and you escaped from the ground. Isn't this what Allah Azza wa Jal talked about clearly in Surah Ali Imran? Where is the Hafiz, who was Hafiz better than me? Where it says, حَتَّى إِذَا تَوَلَّيْتُمْ. In this case says, تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. In other places, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَلَّوْا إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَلَّوْا يَوْمَ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ. Muslims, Muslims, Sahaba, Sahaba. But there is a time, if you let go for one second, you turn your back, you turn your brain, you turn your mind away from this revelation, from what Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, from what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is doing, from what this Quran is about, you turn your back one second. الَّذِينَ تَوَلَّوْا يَوْمَ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ إِنَّمَا اسْتَزَلَّهُمُ الشَّيْطَانِ. The shaitan has pulled their feet away. The shaitan is there. He is the shaitan that Allah Azza wa Jal, and of course, when he talks as shaitan, Allah talks about shayateen al-jinni wal-ins. There are shaitan from jinn, shaitan from ins. There is shaitan from within that works on you, allows you to run away. And then when you wake up and you see that your home is destroyed, your family is gone, your children are killed, your Aqsa is being occupied and being humiliated, now you want back, you want victory. But you can't get it. You raise your hands for dua. Allah Azza wa Jal, and belief in Allah Azza wa Jal is not a joke. It's not a joke that you spend your life in your luxury working for all types of issues, but avoiding, making sure that this Quran is part of the system of life. Why? Oh, I don't want to become political. This is politics. I want to go to politics. I want to remain Muslim. As if politics is not Islam. As if jihad is not Islam. As if ruling with the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal is not Islam. As if jihad is not Islam. As if economy is not Islam. As if stopping riba is not Islam. As if stopping zina is not Islam. No. I am sufficient. I am good enough. Going to 5 times my prayer in the masjid. I'm making my dua. Alhamdulillah. And if I have money, I will make hajj. If I have a little bit less money, I will do umrah and I am fine. Is this Islam? This type of Islam results today in what we have seen in India, the Babri Masjid, and resulted yesterday in what we are seeing in Gaza. That is what resulted. It's not the upper hand of the Jews, of Israelis. It's not the power. Usually, when you lose, it's not because your enemy is powerful. It's because you are weak. It's because you are not up to it. You don't govern how your enemy can equip himself. You don't have control over that. United States engaged in a Cold War with the Soviet Union for more than 40 years. United States could not govern what the Soviet Union will prepare, what type of power they will have, whether they will get nuclear or intercontinental rockets or space type of militarization. They cannot control that, but they can control what they have. You can control what you own. You cannot control what your enemies. You cannot start crying and say, oh, my enemy is stronger than me, as the government of Egypt did the other day. Oh, this is the army of Israel. We cannot fight it. And the Jordanian foreign minister, he was asked, oh, are you going to step in to help the people in Gaza? He said, no, no, no. We don't have sufficient army to fight. We don't have the strength to stand up. They are stronger than us. How pity, mesquine, oh, poor guy. He doesn't have what it takes to stand up for an enemy. You cannot control what your enemy have. You control what you have. What have you done in your life in order to stand up for your rights, for your deen, for your haqq? What have you done? Nothing. What has the ummah done in order to make sure to pressure those regimes and governments? Fulfill your duties. Unfortunately, not. That's why when Allah Azza wa Jal, he is warning here. He says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ وَلَتَعْلُنَّ عُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. There will come that they will get you. They will get you at least twice. Because there is an ayah which says, فَانْعُوَنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا. And if you as Muslims, you fall back behind, then the Bani Israel will come back. Now, Bani Israel, by the way, for those who read and would like to read more, Bani Israel does not talk about the people who accepted Judaism only. Bani Israel are the ones who eventually inherited this deen and were called Christians. This is not to break the world in front of us, but this is reality. If you read Surah Ali Imran, when Allah Azza wa Jal talks about Isa alayhi salam, Isa was sent as a messenger to whom? To Bani Israel. So the whole issue of Christianity, and that's why we see today, as never before, we see that the entire, what we call it Western world, we are being very soft. We are being very, what do you call it, cautious. Or we are trying to name things differently. But in reality, who is the Western world? What do they believe in? This world that's in front of us, put aside Hinduism and Buddhism, which are a different story altogether. There is a story for them. But in the Middle East, in Palestine, in the imperialism of the majority of the Muslim world, who was behind that? Britain, France, America, and they use and they enable the ones who were able to occupy Palestine. That's the reality. Then Biden the other day say, if Israel did not exist, we would have created it. Did he say it? Am I wrong? I think I heard that. He said, this is not an issue of whether we want it or not. This state that exists there, if it's not there, we would create it. Why? Because it serves the interest of that West, or the West that we live in, more than it serves the interest of the people who believe in Judaism. More than the interest of the people who call themselves in the state of Israel. Britain, United Kingdom, in 1917, right at the end of the First World War, the Foreign Minister of Britain, Balfour, he makes a declaration, one-sided. He brought the declaration and he discussed that with wise men and with the whoever was the leader of the Zionist party at the time, that we are thinking about providing a homeland for you to live in. Leave Europe and go live there. We will make it happen for you. Balfour, the British foreign minister. So when Allah Azza wa Jal talks about Bani Israel, Allah knows what he's talking about. Allah is the one who created the world. Allah is the one who sent messengers. And he sees all of this world. So he says, قَضَيْنَا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. This community that at the end of the day descended of Israel, who was Yaqub alayhi salam, and eventually he had all the descendants, the children, the grandchildren, grandchildren, made up a community at large in the world called Bani Israel. And today they are split into two religions, two beliefs, Judaism and Christianity. So this is what the ayah talks about. So that's why when we say that the Salah al-Din, when he fought the battle to relieve al-Masjid al-Aqsa from occupation and liberate it, that was one of the times that Allah Azza wa Jal is talking about. That's one time. We don't talk about things which are before Islam or before the rise of Islam. That's something else. Allah Azza wa Jal is talking to us about our reality. Look, Allah does not talk to us about, this is not a fiction. It's not a history. This Quran is not a book of history. It's a book of reality. It's a book that talks to the people about what is the reality that will face you and how do you challenge that and how you should stand for that. So to make or to conclude part of this talk here is that the talk about Al-Isra and Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and the occupation of Masjid Al-Aqsa, at least two times, it's talking about a reality that exists today. And that shows that with the extreme rise of the entity that would occupy Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, the atrocities will be absolutely tremendous. Will be absolutely tremendous. ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَا لَكُمُ الْكَرَّةَ عَلَيْهِمْ. What says the ayah? ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَا لَكُمُ الْكَرَّةَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَأَمْدَدْنَاكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ أَكْثَرَ نَفِيرًا. So the second time, the Bani Israel will have hold of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa will be much more stronger than the previous one, with lots of money, lots of people, with lots of support from within and from without. And that's what we exhibit today. But what does that need? And here comes the solution that I'm talking about today. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ عِبَادًا لَنَا أُولِي بَأْسٍ شَدِيدٍ. The ones who can stop that are ibad for Allah Azza wa Jal. What says is, فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ الْآخِرَةِ لِيَسُوءُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَلِيَدْخُلُوا الْمَسْجِدَ كَمَا دَخَلُوهُ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ وَلِيُتَبِّرُوا مَا عَلَوْا تَتْبِيرًا. The next time around, there will be a group of people who are called Ibadullah. Ibadullah means the real Ibad is the plural of Abd. And the Abd, when you say, I am Abdullah, it's not a name. Who's, do we have anyone here whose name Abdullah? None? I'm surprised. I have never seen a crowd of more than 20 people who does not have the name Abdullah. طب. How about Muhammad? Okay, at least, okay. And I'm Muhammad too. But, so Abdullah is not a name. Abdullah is not a name. Abdullah is a reality. Is Abdullah or Ibadullah is the one who is absolutely devoted to Allah Azza wa Jal. And when it comes in a plural term, that means it's a group of Ibad. Ibad who is only activity and strength and desires and hopes is to worship Allah Azza wa Jal and to please Allah Azza wa Jal and to make sure that everything goes according to the orders of the Rabb, the orders of the Master, the orders of the God, the orders of Allah Azza wa Jal, everything. That type of people are the ones who can liberate Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and the eviction of the occupiers of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa will not end at this time by people who only want a place to live, as they call it, in peace and in happiness. A small state. I need a state next to the state that occupies Al-Aqsa. That's not it. That's not it. Yes, people, Palestinians, they may get a state. Everybody is talking about the two-state solution. Everybody is talking that we want a state just like they have a state. It may occur, but does that liberate Al-Aqsa? Does that liberate Palestine? Does that make this atrocity end according to the Quran? بعثنا عليكم عبادا لنا أولي بأس شديد. عباد أولي بأس شديد, very strong. عباد الله, not عباد, not the ones who are fighting in the name of Allah to create an entity that's not under the rule of Allah عز وجل. See the contradiction? The contradiction is very tremendous. I am fighting in the name of Allah عز وجل. I'm calling upon Allah and I'm raising my hands for Allah عز وجل. Allah, 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 please help me fight and be victorious so I can get a piece of land that will be ruled yet by one more tyranny, one more nationalism, one more ethnicism. That is not what Allah Azza wa Jal wants. That's not what makes this happen the way Allah Azza wa Jal wants it to happen. And anyone who has dispute with this, read this surah million times until you understand it. Think about it carefully. And as I mentioned, as I said, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter under which banner you fight. It's not the issue of the banner. Because in the time of Uhud, the only banner which was raised, the raya, is the raya of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was no other flag. It's the flag of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only. Real. There were no two ideologies there. It was only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the people, the group of people who were behind him, they had different motives. At some point, different motives. According to the Quran, حَتَّى إِذَا فَشِلْتُمْ وَتَنَزَعْتُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ وَعَصَيْتُمْ إن الذين تولوا منكم يوم التقى الجمعان إنما استزلهم الشيطان. The ones who ran away and turned their back, the shaitan had deceived them, not because the shaitan is powerful, because the ayah says بما كسبوا, because of what you have done, the shaitan was able to distract you. Look, if you read the Quran carefully, you can find answer for everything. Is it true that the shaitan has more power, more strength than some of the people who were educated in the school of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Come on, what's going on? How can I stand up? You'll become confused. If the shaitan is stronger than me, then why am I struggling to worship Allah Azza wa Jal? Because he can deceive me anytime. He can pull me out of the front anytime. No. Allah is very clear. إِنَّمَا اسْتَزَلَّهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ بِبَعْضِ مَا كَسَبُوا. The shaitan was able to distract them and deceive them and tilt them away from the war front بِمَا كَسَبُوا, because of what they have committed inside their brains. The first commitment against Allah Azza wa Jal and against the rules of Allah and against the revelation of Allah comes here. Before you start doing it with your hand, before you steal something, it rises up in your brain that you need to get his wealth, part of it. Before you commit zina, it first rises up in your brain. It never comes out, or you just jump over a woman in the street and make zina. It doesn't work like that. It rises up here. Bima kasabu, bima kasabu. What they earn. In fact, this term earn, earn, that as if you are earning it. It's not a mistake. Sometimes you make a mistake by mistake. You just for some reason you get out of it. You make a mistake, a bad mistake, but you immediately realize it's a mistake. It's not something that you gain. The real sin, the real thing that makes you lose, is once you think of a bad activity or a bad morale, bad ethics, bad act as something, it's a gain, it's a win. Oh, I was able to get 10% interest rate. Everybody is getting only 9%. Ah, I was able to get 10% from that bank. He had some, for a short period of time, giving 1% extra for your money. I took all my money from the old bank. I put it there. Now I have more. And you are happy. You won extra percent of riba. That is kasabu. And you think that, oh, there was this type of lady that no one was able to grab or touch or get close to her. I was able to deceive her, to get her in, and I was able to take her all over wherever I want. So you think that's a big victory. So once you think of what you have is a victory for you, Allah Azza wa Jal says, this is your kasb. That's kasb. Kasb, you gain, you earn. So you earn a sin. Have you seen someone who earns a sin? People do earn sins. And I see people who commit sins. There is a difference between someone who commits and someone who earns. He says, bima kasabu. That means in their brains, something, oh, if I get this type of government, a real nationalist, real Arab government, aside from the Turk government, we are winners. We won. The Arabs, they thought that they have won when they got independence from called Turkey. So they have Abdel Nasser, Nasserism, they have the Sharif Hussein, they have all of these. In Pakistan, when we had Ali Junah, oh, he's the father of the Pakistani nationalism or the Pashtun or the whatever type of nationality or ethnicity he's from. So we got it. Alhamdulillah, we got that. We got this big national flag. We have a big flag now that has three stripes of colors and star. Means nothing, zero. Has no idea whatsoever. We won. The Ummah thinks, the nations among Islam, they think they are the winners. They won nationalism. They won kufr. They won freedom. So they don't want someone to come and push them at the end of the day, get me your zakah. Say, if I want to pay zakah, I will pay it. I believe in Allah Azza wa Jal and I know how to do my zakah. No, no, that's not Islam. Allah Azza wa Jal wants you to have someone up there who collects the zakah and you have to pay it to him. And if you don't, he will take it by force. Don't tell me that I am so keen about my zakah, no one can push me to do that. I know when to give my zakah and to whom I give zakah and how do I calculate it. So you calculate it the way you want. Once you become, you have maybe a couple of $1,000, you are very careful about the 2.5%. Once you get over the million, then you start calculating cost and expenses like the taxes. So I have these expenses here, expenses there, and then you cut from here. At the end of the day, you remain $100,000, you give the 2.5% or $2,500, not big deal. You do it. But your money is $1 million or million dinar. That's not how Islam is. So those things, when you save a penny that you did not pay for zakah, you think you are smart. You think you are smart, you got it, that's kasb. That's bima kasabu. إِنَّمَا اسْتَزَلَّهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ بِمَا كَسَبُوا. Today when the people talk about Nasr, wherever I go, people ask me, oh brother Abu Talha, you talk about Islam, you have been talking so many years. Why Allah Azza wa Jal does not give us victory? Man, did you deserve victory? I'm sorry, even if I want to be a little bit not sarcastic, but metaphoric. If I was the one who gives victory, assume for a second, do you think if you just because you raise your hand and you beg me for victory, I will give it to you? Even I, the human, the person, I will not do that. Allah Azza wa Jal is all wise, all hakim. He's the hakim, he's the one who gives hikmah. Simply because 2 billion people raise their hands at night and they make qunut in many of the masajid in Jordan by the order of the government. The government orders every khatib, please make qunut and jum'ah. And many people, they were surprised. How is it that he's doing qunut during jum'ah prayer? They don't know that qunut can be done at any prayer. Many people don't know. So the khatib now, the imam, he has the order by the government, the corrupt government, the one who is not making any move to support the people who are being crushed, not willing to move an army and crying out saying, oh, our army is not powerful enough, is ordering the imam in Jum'ah, raise your hand in Salatul Jum'ah, make qunut, and after the Jum'ah, make Salatul Ghaib. You pray on the souls of the shuhada. Look, the shaheed is a shaheed, you don't need to pray on him. Don't you know, ya Imam, don't you know that a shaheed, you take him and put him in his grave, you don't wash him, you don't change his clothes, you keep him in his blood, you don't do anything, and you don't even pray on him. You don't pray on the shaheed. They say, no, you have to pray salatul ghaim, absent salah on the shuhada, and in your prayer make qunut. Qunut what? Dua what? What is it that you are asking Allah for? Allah, please take these Israelis and occupiers out of Palestine, kick them out. We will not enter it as long as they are, as they themselves, the Israelis, told Musa alayhi salam, inna lan nadkhulaha ma damu fiha, inna fiha qawman jabbarin. That's what these guys are saying. In Palestine, there is qawm jabbarin. There are people who are absolutely powerful. We cannot go in there. They are too powerful. اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا. Make dua to your Rabb. If your Rabb is powerful enough, let him kick them out and then we will come and liberate them. Guys, this is how much this ummah has deteriorated. Is there a way out of that? Yes, there is. Yes, there is. The ummah should get back to Islam as revealed. Should get back to Islam as was established by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Get Islam to be the rule of the land. Get Islam to be the system of the land. Get Islam to be the one and only one system that rules your life. Get Islam to be the one that collects your zakah, whether you like it or not. Get Islam that can mobilize you for jihad, whether you like it or not. Get Islam that can invent and create and develop their own weaponries, whether they like it or not. Get Islam to be in charge of someone, of the collecting of the money and mobilizing all the wealth. Not my wealth as a poor man, but the wealth that's under the ground that is being fueling the enemies for tens of years. The oil, the gas of the Gulf, the gold in Africa, the diamonds, the minerals, the uranium in Chad. Uranium in Chad, this has been the main source of nuclear powers for the Western countries for the last decades. The largest place reserves in the world of uranium is from Chad. America does not have uranium. And they have the biggest nuclear arsenal in the world. Russia does not have uranium in quantities that could make the nuclear bombs, atomic bombs. They don't have it. Where do they get it from? From Muslim land. Chad, Afghanistan, Morocco, all of these lands, these are the ones that have it. Get a system that makes sure that you develop your own power from your own resources that Allah Azza wa Jal implanted it in your lands. If you don't do that, and then you will come back to Allah Azza wa Jal and say, we need your nasr. Allah said it. إِيَّنْ صُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. When Allah Azza wa Jal gives you the nasr, no one can
beat you up. وإن يخذلكم, but he let, if he lets you down, and he does. When he says, إن يخذلكم, it means the possibility that Allah Azza wa Jal will let you down, he will. Who else can you give, can give you a victory? The ICJ, International Court of Justice, will give you a victory. You clapped all our rulers in the Muslim world. They were praising the rules of the ICJ. Oh, subhanallah, at the end they gave us what it takes to get our right back. Security Council, you are begging Security Council just to stop the war for one day so we can send a bottle of water. And they, even that, they don't give it to you. أَنْ يَخْذُلْكُمُ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدُ. Let's see. Allah takes his hand off. Let's see who can give you victory. It will not happen. It will not happen. You have to stand up on the side of Allah Azza wa Jal all the way. We have been crying about this. We have been talking about this and fighting, struggling for it for tens of years. Every time we discuss, oh, the brother, one more time is reminding us you need khilafah. Yes, one more time. You don't have it. What can you do without it? I'm not going to lie to you and say, no, we can unite the ummah without khilafah. We can implement Islam without the khilafah. We can build the best army in the world without khilafah. We can stand up for the occupation in Palestine or of India or of the breakdown in Yemen or in Libya or in Sudan or stopping the atrocities in Syria. I cannot lie and tell you, no, we can do that. Don't worry about it. Khilafah comes later. No, no, no. It does not come later. If it doesn't come now with the rules of Islam now, all of these issues that I talked about will remain. Will remain. Whether I like it or you like it or you don't like it. Whether the people, they accept it or don't accept it is irrelevant. But it's the truth of the matter. Since the removal of Islam from power, the Muslim Ummah has not seen a single day of victory, has continued to see all types of atrocities day after day, killing after killing, thousands after thousands. All types of weaknesses are happening and continue to happen. Why? Because Islam has been defused. Somebody pulled the plug out. You pull the plug out. Show me how you can have a current that runs in all of these lamps. You have 2 billion electrons, but unplugged. And here is, I will conclude with this example. I was in a small conference organized by Al Jazeera a couple of months ago. Someone asked me the question, how is it possible that with this mass ummah, with mass anger, with massive demonstrations by all Muslims from all walks of life, and we are unable to move one stone in this atrocious war? I said, look, I have a friend of mine sitting on the table, and there was a lamp that was used to make sure that there is good lighting. I told him, could you please unplug that? So why do you want me to? I said, just unplug it for me for 1 second. He unplugged that. I said, what happened to the light in the lamp? Turned off. Why? Unplug. But when you plug it in, what happens exactly so that it gives light? And you guys, especially the young one, you know better than me. What happens? What does this plugging it here do to make the light, to make the lamp give light? It will arrange the electrons specifically in that wire, because there is power, you give that power enough to make all the electrons move in one direction as a group. Otherwise, when you unplug it, what happens to the electrons? Aren't they still there? Did somebody open this cable and let it drip out electrons so there are no more electrons there? No, they are still in the wire, still in the copper. But they are, everyone is spinning around itself. You guys, you know some basic physics at least. There is a nucleus, very small nucleus. Around that, there are tens of electrons depending on the number per nucleus of an atom. They remain, they go back to spin off around, to keep spinning around their atoms, around their nucleus. Isn't this right? What makes them make a current? To provide a light in the lamp. There is power. You plug it in something, you have to plug it into some source of power can line up all of these electrons to make not only one lamp light, but all of this masjid to be light. With one plug, with one source of energy. The ummah, the people are exactly like that. How powerful our young men and women, each and every one of them is a very powerful entity, but spinning around his own nucleus. That nucleus could be his own job, his own family, or his own country, or his own party, or his own nationalism, or his own ethnicity. Everybody has his own nucleus to spin around. And all of us are not making one current. What is it that was unplugged in the Muslim Ummah? Among all these things that we talk about, the only thing that gives power to this Muslim Ummah is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he died, what the Muslim Ummah realized, that all of these electrons, Muslim entities, each and every one of them carries energy by itself. To mobilize that energy, to make it continue in the same direction, with the same objective as it was when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive, is to get Abu Bakr to take the leadership. And that's what's called Khilafah. Unplugged in 1924, 100 years ago, on the 3rd of March, coming up almost exactly a month from now, will be 100 years. That 100 years, that entity was unplugged. And the Muslim electrons have been spinning since that time with all the energy that you can think of. Professors, engineers, doctors, scientists, you name it. Everybody's an energetic in his own. Here in this room, you will find people who have made contributions to this civilization, to other civilization, as much as you can think of. Big energy. But it's not moving in the direction of Islam. Thank you, brothers, and pardon me for taking this session too long, longer than we wanted to do, but we may see you maybe 6 or 7 months from now. So I made up a session for 10. Jazakumullahu khair. Thank you, Brother Ashraf, and all the brothers who are here for this thing. We may have some time for entertaining questions, comments, complaints, whatever you want to call it. Yes. For 100 years, we have abandoned our Islam, and Allah still has not replaced us with other group to accomplish. I hope and pray that Allah Azza wa Jal will not do that soon to us, so that we will bring back the power and the rules and the system of Islam before we deserve that replacement. The only thing I can say, I will not be able to comment on the ghaib, what Allah Azza wa Jal will do and when. All I have to say is we have to do our due diligence to make sure that we are not the ones who will be replaced. We are the ones who are going to deserve the victory of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that to bring Islam one more time into life and please Allah Azza wa Jal, so He will be pleased with us and He will give us the victory. That's what we will work on. But I will be too sad if I will start thinking, counting days. And would that be next year or sometime? May Allah Azza wa Jal not do that for us. And may Allah Azza wa Jal enable us to work hard to deserve His support and victory one more time. Yes, brother.
So, my question is about the gathering.
Yes.
It has to do with someone who provided that content. So, a lot of people, with this situation specifically, would be like, we have to make dua, we have to have that faith, not much we can do. And my question is more so like, they don't have that mentality when it comes to their personal life. So they don't, with their job, they don't just sit around and wait for the promotion. They work hard for it, or with their personal life, with the wife, they don't just sit around and make sure they don't ask your mom to go after out or whatever it is. They don't just sit around and do that. So why is it with situations like this specifically? That's the mentality for a lot of them. And with that, how is it that we can fight that and counter that mentality?
Well, it's a very good question. It really bothers me a lot. Yeah, the question is, the Muslims that sit down in the masajid and spend their time and they just feel that if I make the dua, then that's all I can do and I'm doing it. But when it comes to our jobs, our daily life, we struggle, we fight, we do all that's possible to get the promotion, to get married to the best girl or woman around, and to raise my children in the best manner. And I do all due diligence. When it comes to my own life, that's what we do. But when it comes to Islam, we love to do the dua. See, this did not come accidental. See, I just mentioned that this comes orders. Now, in America, it's a little bit different. It's by inertia, the inertia that comes from the rest of the Muslim world. But because I just came from Jordan, and I know every time after Jum'ah, the Khatib comes and tells me, brother, forgive me. This is what we have to do by the orders. Because he knows me, and I talk to him. He visits me, we talk in private. Then on the khutbah, he says, I had to do the best out of what we are told. This, the Salatul Ghaib, is an order. If we don't make Salatul Ghaib, they will punish us. If we don't call for the dua, Salatul Ghaib is the Salat Janaza after prayer every Friday. And every Friday, we have to do that. At least the Imam will do it. So this is a culture that does not come just like that, because people like to. It's an organized culture that has been distributed to the Ummah easily, slowly over the last 100 years. Over the last 100 years. The occupation of Palestine has been going on since 1948. So for all that time, the main weapon that has been used in the Muslim world is the dua. And they sometimes go a bit farther, collect donations. And when you collect donations, at the very beginning you donate because it's a good cause. But then you will find out that, I'm talking, let's say, specific examples. I'm pretty sure in different places the same. In Jordan, with the country I came from, yes, you collect donations, all of the masajid, but the only entity that's allowed to carry the donations and make the support is what is called the Royal Society of Charity, the Royal Charity, الجمعية الخيرية الملكية. Now, this very entity, which is the royal, is the one that betrayed the Ummah at the time of Sharif Hussein. How is it possible that these people are going to send the real donations to the people? And whatever they send will make the image of this entity that should have been distorted long time ago, you are actually cleaning up the image. So this is systematic. Now, most of the people who run masajid here have been educated or came from the systems that are back there, most. Now, there are now new that come out from the new generation, like your generation, the second generation who are born here. But nevertheless, you get cultured in the same places that have been already bombarded or injected with that corrupt culture that came from the losing Muslim world. The Muslim world had lost it. And they put on top of that Muslim world schools, universities, colleges that graduate muftis and shuyukh who only can give fatwa in favor of the status quo in order to get a job and to be in the system. So this is not accidental. Yes, you may find a place, someone who stand up and say, look, the time is not a time for dua. The dua is good for you, for the one who is here, because that's part of your heart to Allah Azza wa Jal. If he accepts your dua, you will get hasana. That's it. It does not move armies. The dua does not move people from the front, does not give you victory. In fact, I always give this example about this. Ghazwat Badr. Badr is the best example in the history of Islam to take lessons from, the best. And the Quran describes it in very tiny little details in different places, in Surah Al-Anfal, Surah Muhammad, and Surah Ali Imran. These three surahs, they give you the full picture. Now, if you build that image, that picture, make the pieces from these different surahs, put them right here on a PowerPoint, show the flow. The flow is like this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam moves out in order to intercept the caravan. The caravan runs away, makes istishara collects the opinion of the people, Muslims. What do you want to do? Some of them, they say, okay, we'll go home since the caravan is gone. Some of them say, no, let's go and fight these kuffar who kicked us from our lands, who are mushrikeen. So at the end of the day, decides, let's go make the war. Then he comes to the war. Look at the events now. He comes to the place. He starts lining up the people. Then somebody comes and says, Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, if you want to be victorious, don't sit here or station your army here. Let's move a few yards ahead so that we will not allow the people to drink from the water. These we know them as stories, but I will make a point out of them. Then he lines up the people. You guys, you stand up with your arrows. You guys, you stand up with your spheres, the rumh, and you have your swords. And he has few horses, very few. So he spares these horses for some part. He does his due diligence. He acts as chief of staff. And he's the army of Mecca comes stationed in front of them. And the people now, his army, looks and sees, oh my God, massive people compared to us. More than 1,000 with this best Arabian horses. And we are tiny little guys who are barely eating. Our clothes are torn apart, just like one of the Sahaba who was Shaheed there. They could not find enough clothes to cover him because he had as if he was wearing shorts, which is not, but because that's what he had. When they have this, and now they are ready to fight, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stands on a small little hill, a bit higher place, and starts making dua. And this is according to the ayah. إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ. Now this dua is not a dua like we do. It says تَسْتَغِيث. تَسْتَغِيث means it is as if you are expending the bottom of your heart. That's al-istighatha. That's why you say إغاثة الملهوف. الإغاثة والاستغاثة means out of absolute disparity or despair. You are almost grounded. You have nothing. Absolutely. And you make this, you raise your hands as if this war will be a decisive one. And actually that's what he was saying, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah, if this people lose and they get finished, if they get killed, I don't think there's a chance to worship you anymore. Now this is a prophet saying it, not me. But the scenario is that he lined up the people. Imagine for a second, reverse it. Reverse this issue. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh, these kuffar are going to fight us. And say, okay, let's sit down here while still in the borders of Medina. Let's make dua. Oh Allah, kick these people out. Oh Allah, give us victory over them. Where are you? Which front I want to give you victory on? So that mentality, which is how the Quran described it to us, you make a dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, you expose the best of yourself, you expend the best of yourself. Whenever you do the best of your due diligence, yes, I do my homework, I study, I work, I give all my effort, then I say, Allah Azza wa Jal, I did all I can, I did not spare any of my effort. I pray to you to give me the support. That's the natural way. That's the real, that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca, he was in the house of Khadija or in his uncle's house making dua for Nusra, Allah, provide me with people who are Ansar who can give me support to this da'wah. Oh Allah, give me the... And then the people of Medina, they would have come to Mecca and left, and he would not have met them. So come on, get out, go to the street, go to the market, and then make the dua there while you are in the market, while you are shopping for Ansar, for Nusra, shop for Nusra, shop for victory, shop for support, shop for technology, shop for all of these, and make dua. But sit here in the masajid in America or in Cairo or in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, I rarely praise them, but I do praise them because they stopped their form. They made it a crime if you make dua for Gaza and for victory. And it's very funny because in some places those who make dua, you will say it's useless, and those guys, they are forbidding the dua altogether, not because they know it's useless, but because they don't want the people in Saudi Arabia to be associated with this. So that's a different story, of course. So that's why they should be blamed for that, not praised. So don't quote me that Abu Talha is saying what the Saudis are doing is good. No, it's good. It's not good. It's worse than those who make dua, which is useless. But they are worse than that. Yes, brother. Remind me to hug you after this, even if your question is too hard.
My question is, we have seen a lot of mistakes. Why they have not been dissipated to a new.
Because they are under control. I will tell you why. I'll tell you the question is there are so many demonstrations in the Arab countries for Gaza and for the war. The people could have expected that this could evolve into what happened in the Arab Springs, Arab Spring, which means a revolt against regimes. And my answer, quick answer, no, all of these are demonstrations under control. And I will give you a very specific example on this. You've seen in the news this line of the road that was established between Dubai, Saudi Arabia, Jordan to occupied Palestine. You've seen the news, right? And you have seen in the news that the company, the logo of the company, which is a truck company, I forgot what the logo is, somebody brought it up, that these are the trucks that are carrying the aids, the merchandise to the quote unquote the Israeli state. Now, I called one of those who organized these big demonstrations in my city, in Erbil. They organize a demonstration every night. Every night there is a demonstration after Salat al-Isha. On Jum'ah, there is a massive demonstration for all the city. And still going on. And every time, every Jum'ah, they get thousands of people who come out. I called the guy and told him, look, make one of your demonstrations to go and block this road. The road goes through the city. And it goes around your town. Exactly. In our province. I told him, go and block it. Now, if you block it, and you can let some, if the trucks are coming only local for the cause of the local people, let it go. But if it's going to the other side, stop it. Actually confiscate it. Not only confiscate it and make it as funds to go to the people who are in Gaza. This is a real thing. His answer was, oh, you want me to get in trouble? Get in trouble because these demonstrations, they have a cause.
We have seen like 100,000.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Yes. Yes, they are all controlled. They come with permissions. See, the Arab Spring, it came out without permissions. People just demonstrated against governments. So they were not taking permissions like in Tunis, in Libya, in Egypt at the time. That's why they were different. Now, this is critical. The issue of Gaza is very critical. Yes, and the people that think they are doing what they should, they ask them. That's why they come out. Now, who's calling for the timing, the time after prayer, organization? This is the path that we go to. Who's doing that? It's all organized. It's all under control. It's all with permissions. All with permissions. And if it happens that you divert your path, your road, the whole thing is abrogated immediately. Now, sometimes you may hear some slogans come out. People shout with something that's not accepted. You'll find immediately that this will no longer show up anywhere. It will be taken out from all the social media almost immediately, because there are people who come out and they want to say something out of their heart which is not agreed upon. There was, if you remember, in Jordan, there was when al-Jaysh when al-Jaysh al-Arabi when واحد اثنين الجيش العربي when, then immediately try to find it now. It's gone, because the issue here is to show that we are in support of the cause of the people in Gaza for the a new Palestinian state. And we are grieving for the atrocities. But demonstrations that are happening in the Muslim world today, they are all under control. All, absolutely. Absolutely, without exception. Try to call for a demonstration without going through the channels. You will get five people with you only. the ones who organize it, let's go out, you will go out with your three, four, five brothers. But that ones, it's allowed to be spoken in the masajid. You are allowed to call the people in the masjid from the manbar that today we have a demonstration going from this masjid, we'll meet at the following place, and that's what our path. And you cannot take any other path. This is reality I'm talking. I'm not talking this is how it may be. No, no, that is exactly how it's done. Huh? Yes, similar to all over. Yes. Yeah.
The problem here, there seems to be a fatigue in the demonstrations. You know, I've been going almost every demonstration since the start of the question. And even the number of people attending us is dwindling. So it's becoming stale news. Right?
It's becoming a show.
You're hearing hundreds of people every day. You're hearing people farming, not having water, and being bombarded. So even people who had this strong motivation to come up and call their U.S. representatives and senators and call the White House, even that number of people is decreased. And that's very concerning.
Yeah, well, it's because when the dilemma continues, at some point, if you don't see the result of your work immediately coming in and there is some impact, you'll immediately start realizing that you are just wasting your time. And that's the only ones who stay in the street, the one who has to show up at least to show that the problem continues to be there. But what are the solutions? How are you going to make an impact? Especially in America, I remember at the time of George Bush, the son, when people were in, I think there was a demonstration once, almost 2 million people gathered in the square of the White House and the I don't know what's the place called there. His comment was, this is the best thing about our democracy. The government can do whatever it wants and the people can speak whatever they want. I mean, you can speak out that I don't like that. Okay, good. But I want to do that. So I have my freedom as a government to do what I think I should do. And you have the freedom to say, oh, I don't agree with this. That is the best. That shows our democracy at best. Instead of saying that this is what the people demand, therefore we have to follow, he says, no, this is how, and in reality, this is democracy at its best. Democracy at its best. Let the people feel that we can speak our opinion wherever we are, but then things will go according to the elites, how they want things to happen. So, and that's eventually, we already know that things do not get changed by simply demonstrating without specific achievable cause. And the specific achievable cause needs its own methodology. So if you use a method that is not suitable for this cause, you will spend your heart, your money, your effort, and eventually you lose your thrust to do things. So that's why even in science and technology. So look, if you spend your time in the lab trying to invent a new type of technology using the wrong instrument and the wrong ideas, eventually you'll spend all the money and you will not make the objective you want. Not because you did not spend your effort, but you used the wrong instrument, the wrong methodology, and the wrong background of ideas. You may have needed a different theory to prove your concept and different instruments to make it. So this is, in our daily life, this is natural. The same thing in business. If this product requires a certain type of marketing and you insist on doing a different one that you are doing on, you will not sell your product. And the same here. the methodology of stopping the war, or not only stopping the war, but actually liberating Palestine, that method is not the demonstrations, is not the tiny little acts here and there. That's not how it will do it. That may do some type of scratches on the face of your enemy. But in order to get that enemy out of Palestine, you need a massive army equipped with weapons of its own production. You cannot even rely on drones or rockets or anything from different entities. And you must have your own food so your own people will not starve. See, there is a methodology for making an achievement in a certain thing. If that's what you want to achieve, if I want to just to move the issue, just make it live so that people don't forget it, yes, of course, you can do some skirmishes here and there, and people will say, okay, let's get rid of this problem and solve it. Let's wait for the day after, as what we will be talking about next week. So there is a difference between what is the problem you want to solve and what is the method needed to solve that problem. Until today, my brothers, we, when it comes to Islam and the Muslims and our realities and our problems, we do not deploy the logic and the ideas and the thoughts. We do them in our businesses, as the brother was saying a few minutes ago. All of us in our companies, our industries, our universities, we know when they want, a university wants to create a new program, they will have a committee. Find me the objectives. Why do we want to do it? What? Who are the targets? What are type of students the target? Why now? Okay, what resources we need for that? Do we have the resources or not? If we don't have the resources, how can we bring them? How much fund we need? Once all of this is clear, then they announce a program. Otherwise, if we announce a program because we like it, the other day I was in a discussion at my university in Jordan, they want to launch a program, and they just like a program, a new program, a program, and they call the gaming in under computer science. It's fancy, gaming. Everybody loves games, or everybody uses games. They say, we want to have a program on gaming. Would you like to be a member of the committee? I said, first, let me look at this. Did anybody work on the objectives, the real objectives? Did you study the market? Did you study other programs, the success rate, failure rate? What resources you want? What type of, what's the difference between this and the other general computer science? No, but it's very much needed. Everybody is doing it. Okay, God bless you, do it. And we'll see you that you will fail as soon as you launch it. You are dead as born. That's not how you do things. This is how it's done in the back home, these things. Sporadic, everything is sporadic. Just do it because we think it's good. Somebody thinks it's good. The president has seen it somewhere, so let's do that. This is reality. I remember back, I think it was 2008. How much 2008? How many years it's? 12, 4, 16 years? Man, it's been 16 years. But I'm growing too old. The president of the university that I'm working on now, he calls me up. He says, we need to build a nanotechnology center at our university. Nanotechnology center at our university. We need to find a model for that in the US. I was working still here, right? 2008, I was still in this country. We need your help. Then I had a visit. I saw the man. Why do you want to build a nanotechnology center? What is the cause? Who is going to run that? What are the resources? He says, forget all of this. That's not the point. I said, what's the point? He said, the king of Jordan was in the US and he was invited to Mississippi. Look, Mississippi is not University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. It's not Northwestern. It's not Harvard. It's not MIT. Mississippi in university Probably if you will send your son to Mississippi, University of Mississippi and Oxford, which is, they call it OLMS, and it's a very strange story. OLMS, the name of the university, is a jargon which was used by the during the slavery time by the slaves when he wants to call his boss, his Rabb, his boss, when he says, yes, sir, he will say, OLMS. OLMS means like, yes, big sir, like, yes, God. That's a slang word among the enslaved community. And this is the name of the university that the king was invited to, which is absolutely unknown entity. And somebody showed him a prototype for a future nanotechnology center as a senator in Mississippi. Now, to make the story complete, so some people say, why would the king go to Mississippi? It turns out that in that place next to the university, which is called OLMS, was an Indian preserves where it's allowed to build casinos. Because in this country, the only casinos are allowed to be built is a non-federal land. You cannot do it on because the federal government still does not allow casinos to be built on federal lands. It has to be on Indian preserves. So there is a casino there. So the king was invited to the casino with the senator. He showed him it's better than the casino in Vegas or in San Francisco where he has been chased out. He was chased out at one point of time, told him, okay, come over there. So a cover up, he showed him the university and the campus. And there is a place called Nanotechnology Center. So he comes back home and he instructs the Minister of Higher Education, we need Nanotechnology Center. So the guy, he tells me, oh, Abu Talha, Dr. Malkawi, we need, at the order of the king, we need to build a Nanotechnology Center. And we need to do it the way it was done at OLMS. I told them there is a University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, my old university. There is some good nanotechnology center. They have labs, they have fabrications. He said, no, that's not the issue. The issue is to satisfy what the king wants. So the king wants that OLMS to transfer a nanotechnology center, which does not exist, to Jordan and to get funds. Maybe alone he will get. This man does not waste time, because now he puts it on the agenda. So we need another technology center. We need for that maybe $100 million. He gets a loan from the World Bank, and he sends maybe $10,000-$15,000 to the university as just peanuts. But he gets the loan. That's all he is about, is to find on the agenda a project that he can get loan for it from the World Bank. So that's how things are done. And that's why the demonstrations are not functioning. This is how things are done in the Muslim world. Until and unless you make a real revolution, real change, things will not happen. It needs a different methodology. You need the right method for the right objective. That's my point. Right method, right instruments, right tools, right people, just like any project. If the method is too difficult, yes, it's too difficult. Don't change the method because you cannot do it. Sometimes the method is too difficult. If it's too costly, don't look for something because you want to do work. You want to spend whatever money you have. No, I will have to create to make sure that I follow the one and only one method that works. And that's our problem. In this country, if the method is too difficult, they abandon the project. They don't do it with a different method. And when they do, they fail. When they do, simply to put it on the budget somehow or for tax purposes, then they obviously fail. They know it will fail. And they want it to fail because they just want to write it off. Anyway, story is too long. You know better than me. Subhanallah. You should have reminded me 1 hour ago. Yalla, Abu Bakr. Abubakar, and I will not comment on your comment. Make it the final comment. It's yours. The floor is yours. Raise your voice. I want to hear you.
Yeah, can you tell me how many years of the compound? But now what happened in the current time that you can come on ground in the water?
Yeah.
Ground, but the people that are the most popular millions, millions, the characters now. What's the problem is the Panama, that is a methodology, way to work, you know, work for the flood. That's why this is, you know, like the flood, so flood, you know, something happened. Everyone is in the field, country, they have flood, and then this is going to happen to the Kenya. Then you know sometimes that is in first time, okay, how many thousand for the contract.
Just to conclude, there is an ayah in Surah Ali Imran, ayah 165, where it says, أولما أصابتكم مصيبة قد أصبتم مثليها قلتم أن هذا قل هو من عند أنفسكم إن الله على كل شيء قدير. When you are faced with a مصيبة, with a catastrophe, so what's going on? You are you are used to be victorious. What's going on? He says, قل بما من عندي أنفسكم. This is from your own nafs. That's your own work. Blame yourself. So whatever happening, don't blame the others. Blame yourself for something that you have not done. What is it that the Muslims have not done? They have failed to bring Islam to the forefront of their life. And they they have they will be they will suffer out of that, and they are suffering. Yeah, you know, Gaza is not worse than what happened in Syria. It's not worse than what happened in Afghanistan for 10 years. It is bad. It's bad because there is lots of attention, but the wherever these atrocities happen, you can't even weigh them, which one is worse than the other. If you look at anyone, you will say this is the worst. The second one, this is the worst. The third, this is the worst. And this will continue until we shape up. Jazakum Allahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, brothers, and hope to see you sometime again, inshallah.
That's how I feel.